how to talk to God? Boy, that's the million-dollar question. Because if we can figure that one out and get through to the God who created this universe and created you, what a difference that would make. The good news is this. God wants it more than we want it. And He has created us already with the capacity to communicate to Him. It's just a matter of us doing it. That's why the disciples, they wanted to know how to do this, so they looked to Jesus and said, look, John the Baptist taught his disciples how to pray. Would you teach us? And He said, of course. Be glad to. But this wasn't just the only time He did it. He did it on numerous occasions. When Jesus preached the Sermon on the Mount, He also taught the people how to pray who were listening there. It's not so difficult. We make it more difficult because of the way that we approach God, because of the way we live. But God wants us literally to go have a heart for Him and to communicate with Him and to hear from Him. He wants us to be able to tell others what God has been up to, what God's been saying. That's why He gives us His Word. When Jesus was asked that question, obviously, He said, well, let me give you a model prayer. And this model is not so much that you memorize it and say it as often as you can because then it will have an effect. It's not about that at all. In fact, He says in Matthew chapter 6, don't just keep on repeating it, because it becomes something that it's not. This model prayer was meant to register in our mind as we would say it and clue us in on how to approach God. Like last week, we looked at the first little phrase of the model prayer, our Father, who art in heaven. And what He's saying is you need to approach God as a family member. And that's all about you coming to Jesus on the basis of what He did on the cross. And when you receive what He does, then what happens is God sets an adoption process in place and you then become part of this family. And God says, now, since you're one in the family, of course I'm going to listen to you. I'm your Father. I'm always accessible. That's why He put that in there. But then it goes on. And so I want you to sing it with me right now. It's going to be up on the screen there. It's found in Matthew chapter 6. It begins in verse 9. And it's also in your worship guide, in the listening guide. It's right there. Let's say this prayer out loud. Most of you already know it by heart. But let's say it out loud together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, that's the prayer that many of you were taught when you were little, and some of you learned a lot afterwards. But in any case, this is the model prayer. This is the one where Jesus, when He's speaking, He says, let me show you, when you pray, pray this way. And you notice there in the very beginning of it, He says, our Father, which art in heaven. Well, then He goes on and says a particular phrase. You know the next phrase. Hallowed be Thy name. Let me read it to you out of the New American Standard Version there. It's found in Matthew 6, verse 9. Pray then in this way, our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be Your name. There's slight differences there in just updating the English language there a little bit. Now, what's going on there? What is He actually saying there? What is this all about? I mean, if He wants us to treat Him as a Father, a Heavenly Father, then what does it mean when you say, hallowed be Thy name? See, God is trying to get us to see Him the way He really is. When the Bible talks about the name of God, and there are many names for God, and we're going to look at a few of those in just a few moments. When the Bible talks about the name of God or refers to the name of God, like Jesus even says, believe in the name of the Son of God. When that word is invoked, what He's saying is, I want you to approach the God who is, not the God that you've put in a box. The reason God has given us His name is so that we know what He's really like. His name portrays His character. His name reveals to us what He is really like. Now, left to ourselves, we'll come up with some kind of distorted God. And He says, listen to me. I want you to approach me the way I really am, not the way you hope I am. He's so much better than what you hope He will be. So much better. And so that's the purpose of this particular phrase, hallowed be Thy name. Now, what does it mean to hallow? What is that word hallow? Well, I was looking it up and doing a lot of research on that one word because there's so much to it. And it means these words. Let me just throw out a bunch of them your way. It means to make holy. It comes from a Greek word, hagiazo, which we translate sanctify. But it means to make something holy, to set it apart where it has its own place. There's nothing else that can share that place. So when you're saying, hallowed be thy name, you're saying something about God's name. You're saying, there's nobody like you. You are separate, set apart from everything else. You are that different. And it says then, it also means to be the opposite of what is common. When you hallow something, it means you don't treat it like it's an everyday thing that you would take for granted, that you would use any way you want. To make something hallowed means that you lift it up and you revere it. You honor it. You value it. So when Jesus says, I want you to pray this way, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, then what you're actually doing there is it should register, it should kick into gear in your mind that now all that I'm about to say to God, I want it to lift him up. I want it to be all about me revealing to him what I know about him so that I can praise him, so I can honor him, so that I can listen more carefully to who he is and what he's trying to say to me. I mean, that's what it means to hallow his name. It's really interesting. This very thing that Jesus says is the positive of the negative second commandment. The second commandment says, don't take the name of the Lord God in vain. He's telling you what to avoid, and we're going to look at that in just a moment. What does that look like? But this is Jesus' way of saying, but okay, you're not to take my name in vain, but what are you to do then? You're to hallow it. Instead of take it in vain, hallow it. It's either this or that. Our options are not the ones in the middle. You either hallow his name or you disgrace his name. That's the point. So Jesus is saying, when you're talking to God, make sure you don't fall into the rut that all of a sudden begins to take God's name lightly or like it's something common, which it is not. So that's where we're going today. So as I was studying this passage and I was saying, okay, now God, help me. If that's what it means to hallow your name, then help me to see how to hallow your name. What can I do? What does the Bible say for me to know how to honor you this way? And so I came up with a list of a number of things that the Bible teaches. And the more I studied, the more I thought, you know, I work better if I have questions. For me, I want to evaluate my own life. I want to evaluate my own heart. So I like to ask myself questions. Am I here? Or am I doing this? Or is this the way I think about things? To help me process whether or not I'm hallowing the name of God. So inside your worship guide is that note sheet. Pull it out, and I'm going to give you a number of questions. I think there's 7 of them. It started with 12, and I've whittled it down. I'm going to give you 7 today. Questions that are designed to help you hallow God's name. Number one, question number one. How careful are you when you use God's name? How careful are you when you use God's name? Let me read to you Exodus 20. Exodus 20 is the list of the Ten Commandments that were given to Moses that he passed on to the Jews, and they've been passed on from generation to generation. Listen, this is the second commandment. Listen to what God says, this commandment says. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not leave him unpunished who takes his name in vain. So immediately he's saying, if you take his name in vain, it's not like it's something you can pull back. Once it goes, God is displeased, and God is going to deal with it. Does that mean he's going to send fire from heaven every time you let loose the name of God in an inappropriate way? Maybe. But probably not. Because he's more interested in you drawing near to him and treating him with dignity and honor and reverence and respect and obedience. That's what he wants. But he knows that as long as we tolerate the misuse of his name, that we will settle for far less than God's best. So that's what he's saying there. He says, don't take the name of the Lord your God in vain, because the Lord pays attention to that, and you will not leave that moment unpunished. Now, what's the purpose of the punishment? It's what does a father do for his son who disobeys? He punishes. He disciplines that son. Why? So that he'll be better. That he'll learn from this. He'll grow. And the God, our Father, is the same way. That's why he won't let it go, because he wants you to deal with it. He wants you to become the kind of son, the kind of daughter that reflects him. So the first question is, how careful are you when you use God's name? And I've got some other questions in there that I ask myself just to see if I'm violating this one thing. Let me just throw out some of these questions. Do you use God's name to express irritation or frustration? Sometimes we do. People will just say the name of Jesus Christ and they're not calling out to Jesus, are they? No. They're doing it because they're frustrated and they just want to say something, and that just happens to be the word that they allow to proceed from their mouth. This is one of these occasions where God's saying, stop it. Because as you throw God's name around like that, what it means is everybody else begins to throw it around as though it's nothing. God says, do you use God's name to express your irritation or frustration? And you're thinking, but I've just gotten into such a habit of doing that. Well, then it's time to, literally, the Bible says, repent. To stop from doing that which dishonors God and start doing what honors God. Remember, this is not all about what not to do. Jesus is dealing with the positive part of it, and that's the remaining six questions deal with the positive way. But you've got to start here, because there are some things that we do that are dishonoring to the Lord, and God says, stop it. The second little question under this is this: do you use God's name to excuse personal irresponsibility? It's sort of like somebody saying, I swear to God, and then you fill in the blank. And what you're trying to do is somehow get the heat off of you. Get them to, okay, just leave you alone. You're thinking, if somehow if you invoke the name of God, that they'll think that somehow you must be more right than you thought you were. It doesn't work that way. How many times have you blamed God on things that are not God's problem and God's fault? We know from the scripture that we're to do everything in our power to get the word out about Jesus. The Bible says that. I mean, that's why we're here on this earth right now. That's why he doesn't take us home right now. He says, once you've met Jesus, there's no need to stay here unless he has a task. And his task is to get the message out about Jesus. All right? Well, then why are you not talking about it to those that you've been meaning to talk about it? Sometimes they say, well, the Lord just never opened up that door for me. That's using God's name to excuse personal irresponsibility. I mean, God's opening up doors all the time. Our problem is we tend to miss it. We blink, or we don't want to do it, so we just don't look in that direction. And then it gets even worse. I've had men that I've counseled with before who have said, listen, my wife was not meeting my needs, and finally God put a woman in my life who treats me with respect and meets my needs, and so we're just going to get a divorce because I must have not married the right woman the first time. That's using God's name. That's misusing God's name for irresponsible behavior. I mean, there's many ways we do that. Don't blame God on your sin. Don't blame God when it looks like he's not wanting you to have your way. God knows what's best for you and me. Do you use God's name to excuse personal irresponsibility? There's so much more there, but you get it. Look, Leviticus 19, verse 12 says it. Do not bring shame on the name of your God by using it to swear falsely. I am the Lord. That's God's word. All right, another little question here under this. Do you use God's name to intimidate? Well, the Lord told me that you need to do this. There are people that do that. They bully you, spiritually speaking, and they think that somehow by invoking God's name that gives them more authority over you. We've seen extremes here. Jim Jones in the Jonestown massacre, really, where literally they drank the Kool-Aid and they all died. But they were following after this one man, Jim Jones, who in the name of God says, follow me and do what I say and drink the Kool-Aid. And they died. There are many groups like that. That's what this is. Do you use God's name to intimidate others? You sound so super spiritual that, oh my goodness, I couldn't be near as spiritual as you, so I better do what you say God told you to tell me to do. How about another one? Let me throw out another one. Do you use God's name to impress others? God says that's not good. Do you use it to impress others? Titus 1 verse 16 says, they profess to know God, but by their deeds they deny him, being detestable and disobedient and worthless for any good deed. God says we need to be transparent. Quit trying to fool people by the way that you're able to disguise yourself in this spiritual garment. God says be real. And then I got one other question for this. Do you use God's name without thinking? This is so easy to violate. Even this morning, when we're here and we're singing, and the words are up on the screen, and we've got a praise team, doing a great job and just engaging us in worship, And sometimes it's so easy just to read the words, sing the words, hear the word, but never pay attention to them. Because we're busy thinking about what we're going to do at lunch or after lunch while we're actually singing. Now, I know that didn't happen to you, but the folks in the church down the street said it happens to them all the time. It does. You know, we're able to do a lot of different things at the same time. And one of those things we can sure do is not focus on why we're here and still look, have the appearance that we are here to do that. It looks like you worshiped because you were opening your mouth and you were saying words. But maybe at the end of the song, if somebody said, hey, what did you just say? Well, I don't know. See, that's misusing the name of God. When you give the appearance that you are worshiping, but not. You're just kind of taking it casually without thinking. Now, there's so much more here. Let's go to question number two. Question number two. Do you know God on a first name basis? Do you know God on a first name basis? This is a question to help you hallow God's name. You know, this whole point, the thing that I got to thinking about here was what God did in the life of Moses. You remember Moses was the guy that God called to lead the children of Israel out of Egypt in bondage. Well, here, Moses thought in the beginning he was to do that on his own. I mean, it was a miraculous birth, a miraculous life. And when he got to be 40 years old, he thought, now's the time. And he tried to do this thing, and he failed. He murdered a man. He had to flee for his life. And he ended up in the wilderness, Mount Sinai wilderness. And while he was there, he didn't expect to ever meet with God again. While he was there, he became a shepherd for 40 more years. 40 years. He's now 80 years old, minding his own business, doing what he normally does, shepherding sheep. When all of a sudden, this time, he saw this burning bush. And this burning bush was burning, but it was not burnt up. And he thought, man, that's odd. So he runs over there to check it out, and out of the bush comes a voice. And it's the voice of God. And they have this conversation, and God says, I think, Moses, you're now ready. The people of God have been crying out to me for someone to come and deliver them from Egypt. You're the man. And Moses is shaking his head saying, I can't do that. I'm too old. 40 years ago? Maybe. But I'm 80 now. I can't do this. Then I'm also a stutterer. I can't speak. I mean, you need to send somebody who can talk. And he had one excuse after another excuse after another excuse. Finally, he just kind of gives in. Okay. And then listen to what he says to God. Exodus 3, verse 13. Then Moses said to God, behold, I am going to the sons of Israel, and I'll say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. He says, okay, I'm going to do what you said. Reluctantly, but I'm going to do it. He says, now they may say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? That's another way of saying, you know, this sounds a little bit strange, God. I mean, who's going to believe me that a bush appeared in the wilderness and a voice came out of that bush and it was you and I've been gone for 40 years. I mean, don't you think that sounds a little wacko? But God answers the question. I mean, I see this as more of an excuse. But Moses says, who are you? What am I going to tell them your name is? Verse 14, God said to Moses, I am who I am. Yahweh. That's the name Yahweh. I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, I am has sent me to you. And then God furthermore said to Moses, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. And then he wraps it all up by saying, this is my name forever. This is my memorial name to all generations. What name? Yahweh. Here's God's way of saying, all right, you want to know who I am? I'm going to lay it out for you. My name is Yahweh. I am. What kind of name is that? It's the kind of name that God uses to describe his character. He says, I am everything you need. I am able to do whatever needs to be done. That's who I am. I am. My name is Yahweh. He says, you go tell them that I am sent you. And it's the same God who visited with their forefathers. You tell them that. There won't be a problem there. So here's Moses on the inside track with God. He's trying to get out of it, and God says, excuse me, I want you to know my name. My name is Yahweh. Now, you know what's so interesting? I mean, he goes, he ends up going back to Egypt and leading the people out. But what's really interesting is when this finally gets written down in the Old Testament and passed on from generation to generation, when the Jews would come across any passage that would use the word Yahweh, they would not say it out loud because they were afraid of disrespecting the name. I mean, they saw knowing the name of God as a term of intimacy, but they also knew that they were not to play around with this name at all. And they were so nervous about how they would even say it that instead of saying Yahweh, they would insert another name for God, Adonai, which means the Lord. That's how highly they hallowed the name. In fact, it's kind of surprising that we even know what the name is, since there were so many generations where they didn't say it out loud. They just passed it on from written word. And see, in the beginning, the Hebrew language is nothing but a bunch of consonants. There's no vowels. And every word has three or four letters, period. That's it. So there are so many words that have the same consonants, but you're not sure what they say. So but they knew as they read through it, they knew. And I've been told, I asked some of the Jews when we were over in Israel, I said, well, how do you get it? He says, well, what happened was when the fathers were reading the scriptures for their kids, they would just whisper the name, Yahweh. And then it was passed on from generation to generation that way. But they never forgot the importance of the name. So here's the question. You want to hallow God's name? Do you know him on a first name basis? Do you treat him like you know him intimately? Like you've met him? Is he someone that you know personally? You don't know him by Yahweh unless you've entered into a relationship with him. Moses entered into a relationship with the living God at that moment. They were on first name basis. You want to be on a first name basis with God? You have to humble yourself before God. Cry out to him and say, I'm a mess. I'm a sinner. My life is sinful. Doesn't mean you're always messing everybody's life up, but it means that, hey, you've had your share of times of messing people up. But you turn to God and say, God, I'm in trouble. I need you. And I believe that Jesus died on that cross because I'm the way I am. He died in order to pay for these sin. So I accept what Jesus did on the cross, and he's alive. He rose again on the third day, and he's alive to offer me a resurrected life. So not only do I know you've forgiven me on the cross, but you've given me the opportunity to have a resurrected life, a new beginning. I accept that by faith. And then at that moment, God says, you're adopted into the family. I'm going to call you my son, my daughter, and you now know me by name. That's how it starts. Do you know him by name? Are you and God on a first name basis? We need to quit talking about God as somebody way out there who's done all that. No, bring it in. Are you and God on a first name basis? Number three. Do you call on God's name with anticipation? Do you really expect God to answer you when you call out to him? That's another way to ask that question. Let me show you the kind of attitude we need to have. The one that Jeremiah talked about. Jeremiah 33, verse 3. I love this verse. Now, I used to use this verse. I used to claim this verse when I was a student at Georgia Tech, and I'd go into a test, and I knew that I was in trouble. Here's the verse I would quote to God, Jeremiah 33, 3. Call to me, and I will answer you, and I will tell you great and mighty things which you do not know. I didn't know not to go down that road, so I just knew he knew everything. He had to know everything, and I knew very little, and I needed some help on this exam. And you know what? Even in my immaturity, God answered those prayers. I mean, that's the way God is. God just wants us to get in the habit of when we speak to him to expect a response. Now, we may not like his response. He may turn back and say, well, you didn't study any last night. You're going to fail this test. Please, God, no. You're going to reap what you sowed here, and maybe next time you'll study. And I've had my share of those. So don't think that just because you are able to get through to God that he's going to give you everything you want, because there are other things that God wants you to have far more that are better for you. So what's happening here? He's demonstrating an attitude of, when I speak to him, when I call out to him, he will respond to me. There's another example of this that's in living color with Abraham also. You remember the story of Abraham when God appeared to Abraham and said, I want you to go up on the top of Mount Moriah and offer your son as a sacrifice? Remember that? Now, the back story of this is Abraham is now 100 years old, well, actually older than that, about 116 years old. And his son, this is the son that he was promised by God to have. They waited forever. Finally, Sarah had the baby at 90 years old, and Abraham was 100 years old. It's just impossible. It's a miracle that he had. And then they're so glad because finally God gave them what he promised. And now he's about 16 years old, and God says, now I want you to go and offer your son, your only son, as a sacrifice. Think of the thoughts that are going through Abraham's mind. Wait a minute. We waited so long, and we had to have a son miraculously born to Sarah. How can you take him away? But Abraham knew God on a first-name basis, and he knew to trust God. And so listen to what happened. As they're walking up the mountain, Isaac is Abraham's son. Verse 7 of Genesis 22. Isaac spoke to Abraham, his father, and said, my father. He said, here I am, son. And he said, behold, here's the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? His sharp kid. What's going on here? What does Abraham say? Verse 8, Abraham says, God will provide for himself the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. So the two of them walked on together. Enough of an answer for now. But you and I know different. Verse 9, then they came to the place of which God had told them, and Abraham built the altar there and arranged the wood, bound his son Isaac, and laid him up on the altar on top of the wood. Here we go. Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here I am. And he said, do not stretch out your hand against the lad and do nothing to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. This was a test. Verse 13, then Abraham raised his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was an answered prayer. Because you know when God said to Abraham, I want you to offer your son, immediately Abraham's thinking, oh God, surely not. Do it any other way. Don't take this son away. We don't have it recorded here, but you know, as a parent, you'd be saying, God, this doesn't make any sense. Please don't do this. And God didn't. Verse 13, Abraham raised his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram was caught in the thicket by its horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering in the place of his son. And Abraham called the name of the place Jehovah Jireh. The Lord will provide. As it is said to this day, in the mount of the Lord it will be provided. Jehovah Jireh. Here was another time when God says, I want to introduce you to another dimension of my character. I'm a God who will provide, even at your most desperate moments, which this was one for Abraham. God says, my name is Jehovah Jireh. I want you to know that I'm the kind of God that does respond and does provide. Let this story be a constant reminder. When Jesus says, pray in this way, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. To hallow the name of God is to come to God and say, I know you're the kind of God that always provides. You don't always do what I ask you to do because I may have it all wrong, but I know I can count on you to always do what needs to be done and provide what I need. Philippians 4, verse 19, my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory through Christ Jesus. God is a provider God. And Jesus says, when you're praying, never forget that. Number 4, do you think about God's name with affection? With affection. I mean, from the bottom of your heart, do you approach God? Or is it just more of a legal transaction? I'm spending time with God right now because I got to. I'm a Christian, you know. I want to check off the prayer time on my list here so that nobody can ever accuse me of not praying, especially God. God says, I want your heart. I mean, listen to this. You know, Jesus was constantly being asked the question, you know, what's most important? I mean, what is the most important commandment? And he would always go back and find this in Matthew 22, verse 36. The question, teacher, which is the greatest commandment of the law? He said to him, you shall do what? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. He's saying, I want you to love me with you, with all of you, all that is you. I don't want you to segment and say, this is part of me for God. The rest of it's for other things. God says, I want your heart. I want you to know that I'm a God that wants to be treated with affection. That's how he treats us. Well, what does that look like? Let me give you another name for God. Jehovah Rohi. Jehovah Rohi. And it's all found in this psalm that you're very familiar with. The 23rd psalm. You remember how it starts? The Lord is my shepherd. Jehovah Rohi. The Lord is my shepherd. But it goes on and it describes the role of a shepherd. It says, the Lord is my shepherd. That's my name, he says. I shall not want. That means you'll lack nothing when you are trusting and following the shepherd. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He knows that I'm unable to take care of all my needs, so he's going to lead me and take care of me, making sure I have plenty to eat, and I also have a place where I can lay down and sleep, protected from any wildlife, that wolves and lions. And then he goes on. He leads me beside quiet waters. Sheep are very fearful animals, and when they get close to a running brook or a river, they run. Or if they do get close, they tend to fall in. They slip and they can drown very easily. And what he's saying here is the shepherd brings the sheep next to quiet waters that are not moving so that it doesn't scare them away, but also so they can drink. And it says, verse 3, he restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He has everything to do with me on the inside, the anxiety that I have. He's all about giving me this peace that surpasses all comprehension. That's Jehovah Rohi. How do you demonstrate to God, how do you hallow his name? By saying, I trust you. I'm one of your sheep. I need you for everything. And you begin to depend on him. God wants this attitude of dependency where we turn to him first, not second. Where we look to him first instead of going and getting a lot of people's advice. We say, God, okay, I want to hear from you. You may choose to speak to these other people, but somehow give me a word right here. That's how you honor and hallow the name of God, by saying, you come first. I'm going to follow you like a sheep would follow a shepherd. I'm not going to pretend that I could be a shepherd. That's where this is. God wants to know if you treat his name with affection. Then, number 5, there's so much more here, but are you living a lifestyle that honors God's name? Are you living a lifestyle that honors God's name? That's how you hallow his name. Is your walk matches your talk when your talk says, I love Jesus. Listen to what the scripture says. Colossians 3, verse 17. Whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. There's no wiggle room there. In whatever you do in word or deed, what else is there? He says, whatever you do, I want you to do it in the name of Jesus. You hallow his name by just looking at your life and saying, am I living in a way that gives him praise and gives him honor? It's that simple. There's so much more there, but I mean, that's when, if you simplify, you bring it down there. He's known as the Lord, Adonai. And he's just simply saying, are you going to trust me? Let me go to number 6. Because these 6, 5 and 6 are very related. 6, does God's name prompt you to revere him and to live humbly? When you hear the name of God or you think about the name of God, does it humble you and make you want to treat him with much more respect? That's how you hallow his name. Listen to this. Joshua, it's interesting. Joshua is the guy that took the leadership role from Moses. Moses dies. Joshua is the right-hand man. And Moses dies right before they're to go into the promised land. So Joshua is handpicked by God to take his place. Joshua was also a reluctant man. He says, I'm a soldier, I'm not a leader. God, you can't ask me to do this. He says, no, I'm going to be with you. I'll walk you through this whole thing. That's Joshua. So they end up coming down from Mount Nebo, crossing the Jordan River, and the first thing that they're getting ready to do is they're going to conquer a city called Jericho. Before they do that, Joshua goes out and just kind of scope it out, watch it. And while he's out there, it doesn't say what he's doing, but more like he's thinking through, how are we going to do this, God? What are your instructions? And God's going to give instructions on how you overcome and defeat the folks at Jericho. But while he's standing there looking, all of a sudden this other individual walks up. We don't know. He could have been running up. But it says that Joshua noticed this one man. Listen to what happened. It's interesting. Verse 13 of Joshua 5. Now it came about when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, a man was standing opposite him with his sword drawn in his hand. Joshua went to him and said, are you for us or for our adversary? See, Joshua's in military mode. He's saying, what in the world is this guy doing out here? This is a fight. How did this guy answer the question, are you for us or for our adversaries? Verse 14. He said, no, neither. Rather, I indeed come now as captain of the host of the Lord. Translated, I'm in charge. I'm your boss, your general. I'm here to give you instructions on how to proceed. Now, it's at that moment when Joshua had to make a decision. How will he respond to this threat? Well, he obviously knew that this was the real deal. He was standing before. So he responds by, it says, and Joshua fell on his face to the earth and bowed down and said to him, what has my Lord to say to his servant? Does the name of God affect you that way? When you hear the name of Jesus, do you just kind of, or does it automatically cause you to pause and be humbled by what he's done and make you want to live for him? That's what this is about. Does God's name prompt you to revere him and to live humbly? It did in Joshua's case. In fact, the captain even went on. After he falls down on his face and says, what do you want me to do? You're in charge here. It says, the captain of the Lord's host in verse 15 said to Joshua, remove your sandals from your feet, for the place where you are standing is holy. And Joshua did so. This was the most humiliating thing that a warrior could ever do, and that was to take the sandals off his feet, because it caused him to be very vulnerable in the fight. You take your shoes off, you're going to lose. And so what you have is the commander of the Lord of hosts says, take your shoes off. Totally trust me. And what does Joshua do? He takes the shoes off. He says, I do. Jesus says, when you pray, pray this way. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. There's a perfect example of hallowing the name. There's so much more I could give you here. Let me give you one more. Number 7. Are you using your influence to encourage people to take Jesus seriously? Are you using your influence to help and encourage people to turn to Jesus? I mean, this is at the heart of the message. We're talking about connecting people to who? To who?
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ. That's right. That's our task. It's to connect people to Jesus, to make him known. Listen to what the scripture says. Matthew 1, 21. If you're wondering, what's the big deal about Jesus? Why don't we just introduce him to God? I mean, does it have to be Jesus? Listen to this. Matthew 1, verse 21. This is at the birth of Jesus. The angel speaking and says, she will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. The word Jesus translated means Savior. The reason why he wants us to introduce people to Jesus is because that's their only hope. We don't want to just introduce people to a better way of living, try to improve their relationships. No, we want to introduce them to the one that can save them from their sin and then empower them to live. That's Jesus. So the angel in the very beginning says, don't you get this wrong. You shall name him Jesus because he's the one who will save their people from their sin. Acts chapter 4, verse 12. This is after Jesus is resurrected from the dead. He's ascended into heaven. And now the disciples are there about planting new churches and leading people to Christ all over the place. And Acts 4, verse 12 says, and there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved. And they were talking about Jesus. There's no other way. And then one last verse, John 20, Verse 31. But, and talking about the whole purpose of the Gospel of John here. And he says, but these have been written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in His name. That by believing you'll have life in His name. You don't think God takes His name seriously? He knows that His name reveals who He is and what He's all about. And that's why it's so important that we connect people to Jesus, that we don't just connect people with a better way of life. People can, you can improve your life a little bit, but only for a while. God says, I want you to trust me. I want you to hallow my name. When you learn to hallow my name in your lifestyle and your behavior and how you talk, He says, what you're going to find is that you're permitting me to have more say in your life. Hallow His name. When you pray, come to Him as a child with a father, having been adopted into His family, but then once you're there, begin to hallow His name. I promise you won't regret that. You'll see a wonderful thing transform you on the inside.